talk this morning. So let us give him our good ear. Let us not get in a hurry. You know, we live in a fast-paced world. Everything is just constantly moving. We live in a microwave society. Give it to me now, give it to me quickly, because I got things to do, I got places to go, and everything is at the push of a button, a click of this, a click of that. But you know what? In God's kingdom, he still say, they that wait on the Lord. He still say, wait on me. And sometimes we get ahead of God and we go in our own way and we mess up. When we go ahead of God, we do things our own way. God say there's a way that seems right to man. But the end of that way is nothing but death and destruction. So let us learn in this hour, especially as we see the time drawing near, to wait patiently for God. For the Lord truly wants to speak to us. And the Lord, I've been wrestling all week. I remember when Jacob wrestled with the Lord. I've been wrestling all week, God, what you want me to say, Father. Because this hunk of flesh ain't got nothing to say in itself. This flesh that always wants to speak out of itself, I don't want that and you don't want it either. We want to hear what God is saying. And so the Lord gave me this message. And I'm a preacher, I'm a minister, because that's what he gave me. Who is God? Who is God? And you know, when the Lord when his people was in captivity under Pharaoh, and the Lord sent Moses, the first time God sent Moses, he told Moses, go tell Pharaoh, release my people so they can come and serve me. And Moses, Pharaoh looked Moses in the face and said, who's the Lord that I should obey him? I don't know no God, and I'm not letting the people go. You know, that's not a good place, a very dangerous place to be in when men don't acknowledge God, or when men just give God lip service, but the heart is far from God. That's a dangerous place to be in. But who is God? That's a personal question to every believer. To every believer. We have read in the Bible who God is, and every word is true. With one of the most well-known phrases being, God is love. But the words on the page, those words have to make their way in us, because the apostle said he wants God's word to be rooted and grounded in us. They can't stay on the page. They got the word of God got to make its way in me. The way things are going now, you know, we got all kind of threats about cyber threats and all kinds. We don't know what's going to shut down. But when you're walking around with the word, and you can't no devil in hell take it from you. Because that word is in you. You just got it. And so the Lord is telling us, get the word in you in this hour. Because we have an enemy, and his name is Satan. Believe it or not, enemies, people are not our enemies. Now the devil will use people, but the real enemy is Satan. And he will do everything that he can, even from day one, to get this Bible, this word of God out of the church, out of the hands of God's people, and most of all, out of the hearts. Because the Lord illustrated that in the parable of the sower. When Jesus started telling them, a sower went forth to sow seed. And so many times we hear maybe the prosperity preachers has kind of turned this thing around and say the seed is money and the good ground in the church of ministry. No, the seed is the word of God. And the ground is the heart of man. And so Jesus said, when the seed goes out, he said immediately the devil comes and snatch it away. So that's why the book of Psalms tell us, guard your heart. Put a guard over your heart, for out of it comes the issues of life. And so we're looking into the old covenant. The Lord brought certain men to the forefront, and the Lord began to reveal himself to those men. He wanted man to know who he is, because God always wanted a relationship with man. And so he couldn't reveal himself to the whole nation of Israel, because the nation as a whole didn't want to know him like that. Why? Because they knew that there were certain things going on in their midst, in their lives, that they were not ready to part with. So they didn't want to know God like that. But under the new covenant, a way has been made through Jesus Christ, the Son of God, for all who desire to know him, and as much as the human vessel can him that way. But unfortunately, the way is still closed to many believers, because just like the nation of Israel, many believers don't have the desire to get that close to God, because God likes to get too much into our business. You know, he likes to put his finger on things. Don't do that. Don't go there. Don't put that on. You're a believer. Don't dress like that. God likes to get in our business, so we don't want to get that close to him. And so therefore, many believers tell God by their actions, I'm not ready for that level of surrender. I'm not ready for that level of commitment. But who is God to you? Who is God to me? Have we truly come to know him as everything he declares himself to be in his word? God is the giver of life. But we won't just stop there, because some would say, well, I have life. And they would even acknowledge that their life is a pretty good one. And they'll go on to name all of the reasons why their life is doing well, even though Christ may not be the center of that life. We have people like that in the church and in the world. Therefore, we must say that God is not just the giver of life, but he is the giver of eternal life. And eternal life, that is that life which is everlasting. It doesn't begin when we die, but it begins at the moment of true salvation. True conversion, when one begins to live in a direct relationship with God, that's when eternal life begins. From the day you get saved, from the day all of those sins are washed away. And it doesn't mean we're going to fall from time to time. But when we fall, we get back up again. Yeah. And we can get up with genuine repentance. Don't try to play games with God. Because God knows us. You don't try to play games. So you genuinely repent when we fall and do everything you can to turn. That's what repentance means. I'm not going that way anymore. And I'm not going down that street anymore. I'm ready to turn and meet God all of the way. So in John 17:3, the gospel writer says, and this is eternal life, that they might know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ whom you have sent. Psalms 36:9 says, for with you, O Lord, is the fountain of life. In your life shall we see life. And I want to read Philippians 3:7-10 right quick. And listen to what Paul has to say about coming to know God. Philippians 3:7, he said, but the things that were gained to me, those I counted loss for Christ. Yea, doubtless I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and I do count them but dung, that I might win Christ. And that dung means animal manure. That's what I count all of those things that I thought was so precious and so wonderful and that I had to hold on to. I count them as nothing, because I'm out to win Christ and be found in him, not having my own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith, that I might know him and the fellowship and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his suffering, being made conformable unto his death. Paul was compelled to make Christ his everything. He was compelled, every facet of his life was focused on pleasing his Lord and his Master. Nothing else. Now with God being the giver of eternal life, there's much that generates from this source of life for the purpose of sustaining all who will receive this life. From this life comes God's unconditional love and a peace that the natural mind cannot understand. There's an order to this life that God's people must walk in. The Lord presented that order to the prophet Amos like this. He said, you can't walk with me except you agree with me. Amos 3:3. The apostle Paul, by the Holy Ghost, talks about two laws in Romans 8:2-3. He talks about the law of the spirit of life in Christ Jesus, and he talks about the law of sin and death. And the natural carnal life is under the law of sin and death. And that kind of life can never come to know God. There's darkness in the natural life, and that's why the Bible commands us, don't walk walk after this, your own fleshly desires, but walk in the spirit of life. You know, we all know what John 3:16 says, God so loved the world. But if you go down a few verses after that, Jesus said, man bring condemnation on himself because light has come into the world and men love darkness rather than light because their deeds are evil. And that was the state of all of us before salvation. And if we're not careful, we can slip right back into that. Believe it or not, this part of man is always ready to rise up in us. He ain't completely dead. You know, I heard one sister say, you know, I thought I was saved, but one of the sisters in the church kept agitating me, and she said that fighting devil started to rise up in me. Because I didn't know I still had to fight the devil. But just let somebody push the button, you know, and we'll find out what's really in us. So who is God? Moses learned God is a flame of fire in the midst of a burning bush. In Exodus 3:14, he learned God as I am that I am. You know, there's so much in a name. So much so until in the word of God, the Lord changed certain people's name. You know, Jacob was changed to Israel and Paul to Saul and so forth and so on. There's a lot in a name. And sometimes, you know, you run across kids sometimes with names, the kid can't even pronounce the name. Can't even spell the name. You know, so we be careful what we, you know what I mean? My sister have a special needs daughter who born with severe handicap. And you know, when children born like that, the doctors always try to put a lifespan on their lives. But my little niece is 12 years old. And my sister named her Joy. And I'm telling you, all of the adversities that little girl has gone through, many, many surgeries and all kinds of ailments in her body, but that child lived up to her name. She's full of joy. I mean, she has a whole house. She sets up my sister's house is like she's an example. You know, I don't have a care in the world because y'all take good care of me. Don't y'all have a God to do the same? You know? And so my sister would constantly let the word of God play in her ear all through the night when she's sleeping or praise and worship music, and all of that is a big help. And so that's constantly going in her little spirit. And she just stays smiling and she stays full of her name, Joy. So who is God to us? So when the Lord told Moses, he said, I am that I am, he's telling Moses, he said he's using this to single himself out. In other words, the Lord was saying to Moses, let it be known and understood that there is none like me. I'm God. There's none like me. I am that I am. And speaking of names again, when Hannah had Samuel, because Hannah was so grieved because the second wife, Peninnah, had vexed her so much until Hannah began to pray. And that woman prayed, the Bible said, her lips just moved. A sound didn't come out. And that's called deep intercession. When you don't even know how to formulate words, you just go before God and sit there and weep before him. And so Hannah prayed, and when Samuel was born, she said, I have asked him of the Lord. And that's one of the meanings of Samuel, asked of the Lord. And so the Lord told Moses, I also want you to tell the people in Exodus chapter 3 and verse 15, he said, make it known to my people that I am the Lord of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. That is my name forever. Moses came to know God by many names, and this knowing God came through experience, not head knowledge. And for this reason, the Lord made him a great leader, because Moses wasn't satisfied with the shallow knowledge of God, the way God's people were. The Bible said in Psalms 103 and verse 7, he said, the children of Israel knew God's acts, but Moses knew his ways. You see, his acts were what God could do for them. They saw how God made provision in the wilderness with the manna. They saw how he rained down that bread from heaven. They saw how the water gushed forth out of the rock. But when it seemed that God wasn't doing anything for them, the murmuring and the complaining began among them. because that was the extent of their knowledge of who God was. But the ways of God was not what he could do for his people, but the ways of God was why he did what he did. And that's what Moses, the servant of the Lord, knew. He knew why God did what he did. He knew that God had put restrictions on the lustful desires of their carnal nature and was giving them only what they needed because he was proving them, or he was testing them to see if they would walk in his ways or not, to see if they really wanted him or if they just wanted the blessings, if they just wanted what he can give to them. And out of this experience of Moses coming to know God in such a way, a love for the people of God developed, was birthed in his heart. A love that transcends beyond their rebellion, their stiff neck, and the hardness of their heart. Moses constantly went before God, pleading their case, and God showed forth his mercy many, many times. God could have easily wiped them out, because they were constantly walking in rebellion and disobedient to God. But here was a man who was a great intercessor. Moses could have stood and said, God, I'm sick and tired of this. I don't want to deal with it anymore. But Moses kept going to God on their behalf and crying out for them. Moses was always in the process of desiring them to know and learn more and more of who God was. And he wanted the children of Israel to have that same desire. He was always stressing to them the heart of God, the voice of God, the ways of God, in hopes that it would stir a deeper hunger in them, so they would live wholly for God and not vacillate back and forth. One day they're living for God, the next day they're looking over at the other nation who want to be like them. They want to be like the other nations. They felt like God had them too restricted. They felt like they couldn't move like the other nations did. But God was doing this for their own benefit. He wasn't the God of the other nations. He was the God of their nation. And he wanted to use them as an example for the other nations. Moses desired to get them out of that place of only knowing God when the blessings came. But when there was no blessings, they felt they had no testimony. There's a cost that comes to getting close to God. There's a cost. Moses paid a tremendous price to have that relationship with God. He paid a tremendous price. You know, when they first came into the wilderness and the children of Israel, they started complaining because there was no water in the wilderness. And the Lord told Moses, smite that rock, hit it. And when Moses hit the rock, the water came out. And then we journey on through the book of Exodus, where they come to another place again where there's no water. By this time, they had gotten on Moses' nerves, and he called them rebels. He said, I'm tired of these rebels. And so God told Moses, this time, speak to the rock. Moses let them get under his skin. Instead of speaking, Moses hit that rock. And the Lord became angry. We don't believe God get angry, do we? He does. God gets angry. So God became angry with Moses, because he said, you failed to sanctify me among the people. And so when Moses hit that rock instead of speaking to it, God said, okay, you're not going in the promised land. You're not going in. I'll let you see it, but you're not going in. There's a cause to come. You know why God did that? Because God said, okay, Moses, you've gotten too close to me. I've shown you my glory. I've shown you my face. I've speak mouth to mouth with you. I've done all of these things with you, Moses, that I haven't done with the children of Israel. Even when Korah and company rose against Moses, they told Moses, who do you think you are? God didn't just talk to you. And so God told them, God heard this. When we talk, sometimes we're more afraid of people than we are of God. You know, I ain't doing such and such as pastor looking. No, God is looking. God is looking. And so when we're in secret, always know the Lord's eyes are upon us at all times. And so Korah and company, it rose up against Moses. And the Lord heard what these men said. And the Lord told Moses, step back. Step back, let me handle it. And so we know that the earth opened up and swallowed these men up. God said, no, you don't mess with those that I've called out. And even brother and sister rose up against him, Miriam and Aaron. They rose up against Moses. Here God comes again. And God called out three of them out. And he began to speak to Aaron and Moses. And he said, listen, if a father spit in her face, shouldn't she be sent outside of the camp? So when God finished speaking, guess what? Miriam was left with leprosy. Why Aaron wasn't struck, the Bible didn't say. But it affected Aaron. Aaron went on to Moses, the same one they rose up against, and said, Moses, cry out to God that he heal Miriam. And that's what Moses did. Moses didn't say, no, because y'all should have kept y'all mouth closed. This man, the Bible said Moses was the meekest man on all the face of the earth. And so Moses went down on his face again, and he cried out to God. And God said, let her stay outside of the camp for 7 days, which she did. So when you walk in with Jesus, when you're living for the Lord, don't worry about what people say. God is your defender. The Lord will rise up and defend. You don't have to say a word. God will rise up and defend those that belong to him. So Moses wanted them to come to know God in that way. He wanted them to come to know the Lord. And we also have, I'm going to say this little quick story about Peter. We know Peter was one of the Lord's disciples, and Peter swore up and down, I will never, ever deny you. Once again, we don't know what's in us until the heat is on. We don't know what's in us, but we know Peter ended up denying the Lord. And after he denied Jesus, he didn't want to walk close with them anymore. The Bible says he walked with Jesus from afar. He didn't want to get too close to Jesus because he saw they were about to take the Lord and crucify him. And Peter didn't want no part of that. So when we say we are fully committed, we better know what we're talking about. Because we're going to be tried in ways we've never tried before. We're going to be severely tried by the hand of God to see if we are people that are ready to give our all to follow him. In the time that we live in, we must come to know God beyond this materialistic world. Because everything that we have worked so hard for, attained and accomplished, thank God for the things that we have. There's nothing wrong with that. But those things won't be able to give us what we need to endure what's yet to come in the troubled days ahead. Yeah. Nothing that we have is going to help us with what's yet to hit this earth. We watch TV and we see that war over there in Ukraine. You don't know what's coming here. You don't know what's coming here. We hear all of this talk about this man got his finger on the nuclear weapon. We don't know what's coming. Amen. So we better set our hearts to see God while he may be found. Amen. You know, under the new covenant, God the Father desired to reveal himself to the church through his only begotten Son, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Let us look at the picture that the prophet Isaiah painted of Christ in Isaiah chapter 53. In the eyes of God, Isaiah said he was a tender plant sprouting from a root in a dry ground. This means that his mission on earth was not going to be an easy one. Can you imagine planting a tomato plant or any other plant in a pot with hard, dry dirt? Can you imagine that? So all of the conditions around the Son of God were unfavorable for what he came to do. Because in the eyes of man, he was very unattractive. The prophet Isaiah said there was nothing, nothing there that would desire us to own him, nothing. So the church or anyone else, you can't just say, I love the Lord, off the top of our heads. Because a relationship and a fellowship with Jesus Christ has to be culminated daily, because we can't love him until we get to know him. When we get to know him, that's when we fall in love with him over and over and over. Once we get to know him, we fall in love with him more and more. When we get to know him, just the mention of his name, something leaped inside of you. You remember when Mary and Elizabeth, you know, Mary was pregnant with our Lord and Savior, Elizabeth pregnant with John the Baptist. And when Mary went to Elizabeth's house, as soon as she saluted Elizabeth, the Bible said that baby leaped in her womb, just hearing the name of Jesus. You know, there are times I would go in the store and complete strangers, I don't know these people. They can be down kind of dog food. I don't even have a pet. But if I hear somebody talking about Jesus, my basket turned right down. Because you can call on the name of somebody I got a relationship with. And here I'm starting up a conversation with complete strangers. But the thing we have in common, we love Jesus. That name does something to us. At the mention of his name, things change. At the mention of his name. Oh, how I love the name of Jesus. I love his name. I love it. You know, John the Baptist came to know Jesus through a prophetic assignment given to him before he was even born. Now, the fulfillment of this prophecy was short, but it was anointed by the power of God. When John came on the scene, nobody introduced John. John introduced himself as a voice of one crying in the wilderness. And you know, that's our protocol, and nothing is wrong with it. You know, when we have special guest speakers, we introduce them. But nobody was there to introduce John. He introduced himself. And the Jews heard of him. They sent a certain group of people to ask him, "Who are you?" And they expected John the Baptist to give them some long, lengthy introduction of himself so they would have something to report back to them that sent him. But John stuck to that one single phrase, "I'm a voice. I'm a voice of one crying and pointing the way to Jesus. I'm a voice of one crying." So he stuck there. John could have went on and gave him a long, lengthy introduction. You know, he was prophesied by Isaiah before his birth, and he was the one that was going to come before Jesus. He could have said all of that. But John said, "Who I am is not important." Therefore, he declared to them that Christ must increase, but I must decrease. When Christ comes on the scene, John said, "I begin to fade out. Because I don't want all eyes on me, but I want all eyes on him. I want eyes on Jesus. He's the one." God is the fulfiller of his word. You know, we just finished talking about John the Baptist, but there's another John in the scripture, and that's the Apostle John. So we're going to talk about him. And the Apostle John started his relationship with Jesus by coming to know him as, in the beginning, was the Word. And the Word was God, and the Word was with God. And his experience with the Lord didn't stop there. But as he continued to write 1 John, 2 John, 3 John, and all to the book of Revelation, his knowledge and experience with Christ increased. He came to know God as light, and there's no darkness in him. The world is dark, and that's why the apostle tells us in 1 John 2:15, "Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, then the world, the love of the Father is not in him." And you might say, well, the Bible says in John 16, God so loved the world. And here John is saying, "Love not the world." Is that a contradiction? No, it's not. God so loved the world, meaning that he loved every creature that was created by him. And when John says, "Love not the world," he said, don't love what the world stands for, the sin, the ungodliness, nor the things that's in the world, the lust, preoccupation with gratifying physical desires, materialism, craving for and having greed for things, pride, obsession with one's own status of importance. John warned us not to fall in love with such things, because if we do, he pronounces that the love of God is not in us. It's not in us. So we don't want to get tied up in this world system, because this world and the system is going to pass away. The word of the Lord abides forever. In the gospel that was written by him, he came to know the Lord as the living word. He came to know him as the true life, the true vine. And when John put that word true before light and vine, it must indicate that there's some imitation somewhere out there. So he said, Christ is the true life. He's the true vine. He came to know him as the only one to cause a man to have a second birth. A birth that's neither of flesh nor of the will of man, but one who is born again by the power and the will of God. You know, he told Nicodemus that. Nicodemus couldn't figure it out. How can I be born again? Do I go back in my mama's womb and come out a second time? The Lord said, no. They that have been born of the flesh, that's flesh. But you have to be born of God. When you're born of God, It's a mystery that man really can't explain. But the Lord get in you and you take out that old stony heart. He take out all of those old wicked desires that we had when we were out there in the world. He take all of that out of us and he put himself in us. That's why the word says Christ in you, the hope of glory. That's why the Holy Spirit comes to dwell in you. He comes to live in us. And that's how we become new creatures in Christ, when we have been born again, born of the Spirit, born of God. In 3 John, he hammers in on the fact of how he had come to know God's love. And in Revelation, all of the experience that he had with the Lord culminated as he found himself banned on the Isle of Patmos. If he had not had an ongoing walk with the one who had come to love, no doubt his testimony would have been very different. Maybe even a tragic ending. Because when we limit our knowledge of God to blessings only, we're setting ourselves up for a great fall when the day of trouble comes. Or we limit him to just human like as we are, or as some say he was just a man, then we don't know him, because he was more than just a man. He was the Son of the living God. He was Jesus, Messiah. He came in flesh as a man to identify with the feelings of our infirmities, to identify with our temptation, but yet he was without sin. And that was the divine side of him. He was man, but he was absolute God. Some of Jesus' disciples who thought that they knew the Lord was tested severely when Jesus began talking of himself as the bread of life. Now we know what natural bread is, and that's the way they were thinking. Because they told Jesus, listen, our father ate manna in the wilderness. Jesus said, yes, they did. They ate that manna, but they are dead. This natural food has limits. But this bread that I'm talking about is my flesh. And if men eat my flesh, he shall never die. What is Jesus talking about, eating his flesh? Well, this is the flesh right here. If you eat my words, you won't ever die. Who is God? Can we or have we accepted him as our only source of life? And with this being Communion Sunday, can we eat of his flesh and drink of his blood? This simply means, can his life become all that we would ever desire? Can we know without a doubt that we are part of him? So God is asking all of us the question, are you willing to come to know me? Even if the road and the journey get hard, even if I start putting my finger on things in your life, you still want to get close to me. For I desire to get close to you. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah.